Hello. Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Hector Tobar, is one of the finest writers in America. He has written a superb novel. Now comes this nonfiction book that reads, it could be a novel, and then you would have said, ah, couldn't have happened. This is The Untold Stories of 33 Men Buried in a Chilean Mine and the Miracle That Set Them Free. Deep, Dark, and Down. And it's published by Farrar, Straus, Giroux, and Deep, Down, Dark. Welcome, Hector.
Thank you for having me.
Well, come on. Thank you for writing this book. I couldn't put it down. It is absolutely mesmerizing the way you've written it. Beginning with the fact that men, a couple of men who live further away from the mine, they make $1,200 a month. And in Chile, that's a year's salary for pretty much the lower middle class.
Right.
And they're living upper middle class, being mine workers. Now, they get to this mine, and it is the San Lorenzo.
The San Jose mine.
San Jose mine.
Yes.
But it is a mine that has not really been cleared for safety.
Yes, it's a very dangerous mine. It's a place where the men who work there are men who have not been able to get jobs in other places. The men who work there were known in the local industry as kamikazes. So the mine is 120 years old. It's a family-owned mine, a very small mine by Chilean standards. Chile has huge mines, government-owned mines that are like entire cities. This is a mine that employs, average shift, 25 men or so. On that particular day, there are 33. And they're getting copper ore and gold ore out of the earth.
And in some ways, if one thinks of Thornton Wilder's The Bridge of San Luis Rey, what were they doing, those 33 men, one or two who were working extra hours because they were buying something and they could use another $15?
Exactly. There was one man who took a pause from his work, drove up to the surface to have lunch. He was going to have his rice. He would heat it up in the microwave, and he thought, you know, if I go down right now to the bottom of the mine and pick up one more load, I'll make another $10 or $15. And so he drove down to the bottom of the mine and got collapsed and got trapped in the collapse. So he basically put his life in danger for $15.
And the owners of the mine, two families, they really had not done anything to improve. And they had a man named Pinello, is that his name?
Pinilla, yes, Carlos Pinilla.
Who is the general manager,
yes,
of this mine and another mine that they owned.
Exactly. He ends up being, for the miners, he's the villain of the story. He's the person who went down on the mine, knew how dangerous it was a really strict boss, didn't tolerate many of the men's complaints about safety, and ends up leaving the mine just an hour or so before it collapsed. And many of the men think that he knew it was going to collapse. He denies this. He says, I had no way of knowing this was going to collapse. I thought the mine was going to last another 20 years. But he leaves the mine, and he's sort of a symbol of just the thoughtlessness in which this mine was operated and the dangers that were present there.
Yeah. Now they're going down in, and there's a man who is considered the leader of it, and he wears the white helmet.
Yes. Yes, in Chile, a white, you know, the men wear helmets of various colors, but a white helmet means that you're a manager. And so when you say, you know, he's a casco blanco, a white helmet, it means he's a manager. He's someone who makes more money. He's a supervisor. And so on this particular shift, the supervisor was Luis Rosua. He was the one white helmet down there. And he, when the collapse happens, he ends up not knowing what to do. He's almost mute. The men are looking for leadership, and he says, no, there can be no leaders here anymore. There's no way to get out. I take off my white helmet, and now we make all our decisions collectively. A lot of the men thought that that was an abdication of responsibility.
They find that there is a place called the Refuge.
Yes.
This is where they would go to have lunch if they had the time. And there was a locked up, I guess, sideboard that they knew supposedly would have Red Cross help, food if needed be, and water.
Yes.
Big joke.
Big joke. It turned that, yes, they, according to Chilean law, this cabinet is supposed to have enough food to keep 25 men alive for 2 days. Well, for starters, there's 33 of them, so that's a bit of a problem. And then secondly, they open up the cabinet and there is cookies, a few bottles of water, a few cans of tuna. There's 100 packages of cookies, children's cookies. These few cans of tuna, a can of peas, a can of peaches, really not enough for the men to survive more than a day or so. And so they agree to ration it. But before they ration it, several of the men are really hungry. They skipped breakfast that day. A lot of the men would never have breakfast when they went into the mine because they knew that the conditions were so poor down there, the heat and the humidity, they knew they would throw up after a couple of hours. So they've skipped breakfast. They didn't have lunch because the mine collapsed on them during the lunch break. And so they raid the food supplies. Four or five men steal a good number of the cookies. And so as they realize they're going to be trapped there for a long time, they have less food than they thought they were going to have.
Reading the book and seeing how it was like almost a underground city. It was going down this road and that these big trucks could get down there.
Yeah, the opening to the mine is 5 meters by 5 meters, big enough to drive a dump truck through. In fact, dump trucks went in to take the ore out. And the mine is constructed first as a highway, a sort of spiral highway that goes down into the mine. First it's switchbacks, then it's a spiral. And it goes down at a 10% grade, so the road is actually several miles long to get to the bottom of this 2,000-foot mine. And then it has these veins of ore that are in it, softer rock, and passageways that go down to get that rock out. And so it is a huge, I call it an iceberg city, because on the top of this rock, there's a few buildings, and then there's this whole elaborate structure underground.
And this, when this dolomite that cracks in, it's bigger than Empire State Building.
Yeah, I had the good fortune of having access to a Chilean government report that tried to explain what happened, see who was responsible. And the Chilean engineers found that this big block of granite-like stone called diorite that broke free was twice the weight of the Empire State Building, as tall as a 45-story building. And it came crashing through the mountain. And when it did, it caused an earthquake underground and trapped the men.
And the rumbling, I mean, we who have lived through earthquakes here know that afterwards there is the sort of residual earthquake sounds that come. But this was more than that.
Oh, yes. It was It was like living inside of an earthquake is the way I describe it. At one point, you know, a lot of us who lived in Southern California, we lived through earthquakes or we've seen videos of how the ground can undulate in an earthquake. So these men are in these stone caverns, and one of them told me that he saw the stone walls of the caverns undulate, move like waves. And so this collapse, they're inside this earthquake, and then for the remaining days, they continue hearing these rumbling and these tremors that come through the mountain. And so for them, that was a kind of a psychological torture that they lived through.
Even one of the men tries to slide under this massive, it's impossible to even think about what to call this massive stone that's there. And of course, he can't go beyond a certain amount.
Yes.
But they are locked in. Now, they don't all stay in one area.
Right.
Some stay in their car or their wagon. Some go into another floor almost.
Yeah, it was almost immediately became this study in human nature. There was two groups. The men divided into two groups. Those who said, we're going to sit here and wait in the refuge, try to use as little energy as possible and wait for someone to rescue us. And in fact, after a couple of days, they started to hear drills coming towards them in the stone. The stone walls began to vibrate with these sounds of these faraway drills. So those men waited in this room called the refuge. It became very quickly, the atmosphere there became very foul-smelling and just, you know, people with bad moods and very angry. And another group of men tried to find a way out or send a signal to the surface. They climbed through the chimneys to try to make it to the top. They tried burning tires. They tried hitting the stone walls with the machinery they had. to try to send a signal to the surface. And so very quickly, the men broke into competing camps.
And on the surface, wives, daughters,
yes,
girlfriends are suddenly coming. Wives who did not know the husband had a mistress.
Right.
The mistress who thought she was still important to the husband. They're all coming and forming a camp.
Yes, exactly. I'd heard a lot about Campo Esperanza, Camp Hope, even before I went to Chile. But in my first interviews with the men, several of them wanted to have their wives or their girlfriends present. And so I began to talk to the wives or to the girlfriends. And I heard these stories of what was happening in the camp, and it was this very dramatic scene up there of these women harassing the authorities, demanding that the authorities try to find their men. It was a very, very compelling scene, and so I ended up writing big sections of the book about the women on the surface.
If you hadn't, or if they hadn't, the president, the whole country wouldn't have cared. They would have said, well, they died, and there would have been a speech, but they kept that urge alive.
They did, and I talked to the Minister of Mining, who ended up becoming one of the main officials leading the rescue, and he told
me... Is that Mr. Gold?
Yeah, Mr. Lawrence Goldborn, yes,
yeah.
Lawrence Goldborn, who at one point was considered a favorite to be elected Chile's next president as a result of what did happen in the rescue, although that didn't happen for him. He had to drop out of the race. But he told me that he remembered when he had to announce that there was no way to reach the men, that he saw the daughter of one of the miners crying, and he could see the tears filled up her eyes. He said it seemed like more tears than her eyes could hold. And that moment caused him to cry. And when he wept on television, you know, it was a very dramatic moment in Chile to see a government minister weep on television. It's something that, you know, that sort of drove home the point of what was happening. And that was actually a key moment in the rescue. One of the reasons why the government ended up investing so much was because Lawrence Goldborn had this dramatic moment on television.
Yeah. And the president now gets involved because, again, politically, he thinks he's got a chance to get more votes, more support.
Yes. I think that the government did not have to get involved, and it was actually a very brave decision for the government to say, we're going to take control of this rescue, because in Chile, it's the mine owners who are responsible for the rescue and very often organize the rescue. So the government stepped in, realized that this was beyond the capacity of the mine owners to do anything. But then very quickly, especially after the men were found, the Chilean government realized that this was a political boon. And as I describe in the book, the president was actually conducting polling. You know, how are people seeing me? Who's more favorably seen? At one point, he was concerned because the Minister of Mining, Mr. Goldborn, was actually more popular than he was.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, people realized in the government that it was great. It was great political show that was going on, drama going on.
Meanwhile, down in the tank, there's a man they refer to as the pastor.
The pastor, yes.
And he had been an evangelical,
yes,
Christian. And he comes and he starts to pray. And the men, after a while, start to all join in. It doesn't last forever, but for the time that it does, it is very moving.
Oh, it was absolutely, I heard so many stories about the prayers, but the first person to sort of tell me about how special it was Yoni Barrios, who later would be famous as the man with the two women fighting on the surface. And he saw another miner, Mario Sepulveda, who is going to become famous as Super Mario later. And in fact, when the movie comes out next year, he will be played by Antonio Banderas, Mario Sepulveda.
Ah.
So Mario Sepulveda issues this call to prayer and says, I'm so angry. God damn it, I want to pray, he says in so many words. This isn't fair, what's happened to me, I've had such a hard life, we need to pray, we need to speak to God. And he turns to another miner, Jose Enriquez, who's known as an evangelical, and says, we know you're a man of God, will you lead us in prayer? And Jose Enriquez, from that point on, becomes the pastor, because he, more often than not, leads the prayer. He knows biblical parables and biblical stories from memory, and so he tells them from memory. The story of Jonah and the whale, the story of Jesus and the bread and the fish feeding the multitudes, because they're going hungry, so he tells a story about feeding the multitudes. And it was a really funny moment. Yoni Barrios told me that, you know, it just felt like we were in the Bible, you know, because they're trapped in these stone caverns. This monster of a mountain is groaning at them that's going to kill them, and they're praying. It just really felt like they were in a Bible parable.
There's a man, too, who's known as the soccer. He had played soccer.
Yes.
and had evidently had quite a good career at one point.
Yes. Franklin Lobos was someone who had a great career locally in Chile. He'd actually made the Chilean national team briefly. He was known as the magic mortar, El Mortero Mágico, because he had a great right-footed shot. And he had been famous, but now he was down on his luck, and he's driving a taxi to help pay for his daughter's college tuition. And so he's already been famous. And so he's trapped down there with them. He's later going to see how the men deal with their own fame. So he was trapped down there, too.
Yeah. He was fascinating. I hope he's in the film, too.
I think that Franklin Lobos is in the film. And Franklin is wonderful because he's already been famous, and he has really sort of been humbled by the fact that he's become a taxi driver and then a truck driver inside of a mine. He gives the men lessons about what it all means. He himself is also a really gruff personality. So, yes, he was another person. Yeah.
The other person is the sister, Maria, who is, she becomes so important that they refer to her as the mayor of the city of Esplendidos.
Yes.
And in real life, she runs a sort of sidewalk, food.
Yeah, I kept on hearing stories about the mayor, la alcaldesa, as they say in Spanish. You know, this woman, they called her the mayor. She ran everything. And so I said, I have to talk to her. And so I was in Copiapó, which is the city closest to the mine. And they telephoned her and said, this writer would like to talk to you. So she has to take a bus for like 4 hours from where she lives. She sells empanadas. She's a street vendor, a grandmother, I think about to become a great-grandmother of in her 50s, believe it or not. And she came down and talked to me. And she came down during the crisis. Her brother was trapped. And from her and from her brother, I heard these stories of how poor they had been as children. And so she was the older sister in this very large family growing up, and she had to raise her siblings. She was used to protecting her siblings. So when her brother gets trapped in the mine, she says, I have to go to the mine, and I have to fight for him. I have to protect him. And so she becomes the leading spokesperson of the families and talks to the president, talks to the minister of mining, and says, you have to do everything you can. And so she becomes the leader of the families.
Now they are there. They have gotten this government interest, and the government doesn't have enough of these drills to go. So they're getting 4 drills from various countries, including the United States, Israel, Italy, and another one, Netherlands maybe, mm-hmm. that were drilling in a hole to try to get a hole that will be big enough mm-hmm. to at least put another hole down to bring the men up.
Yes, because the first, there were 17 different holes being drilled at first, to find the men. And those holes were all smaller because it's faster to drill a smaller hole than it is a big one. And so the idea is to find them first. So they drill these 4.5-inch holes, and one of them finally finds the men. It's a scene of jubilation in Chile. They're all alive. A note comes up. It says, all 33 of us are here. So there's jubilation in Chile.
With some red paint on it.
Yes, with red paint on the drill bit and everything that the men spray. Then they have to get them out. And so they have to drill a 25-inch hole. And it becomes this extraordinarily difficult technological engineering feat. And yes, they have the 3 different mines, drills going at once to reach them and get them out. And meanwhile, the men below are beginning to get letters from the surface, and they realize they become famous.
Yeah. It's so famous that they now said, wait a minute, no one talks to anybody except for all of us. No one makes a contract for any book unless it's all of them. What's interesting how they were smart enough to know to protect themselves.
Yeah, I think that, yes, they were definitely astute about what was happening on the surface, because they're getting their wives, their girlfriends, their moms, their dads are getting, contacts from Italian television, from Spanish television, from Japanese newspapers saying, we'll pay you for an interview. And so the men realize that there's money to be made, that they've become suddenly from these men who were forgotten in a hole, who thought they were going to die in the dark, who were dying of starvation, lost 20, 30 pounds in the first 3 weeks that they were trapped down there. Suddenly, they're the most famous miners on earth. And so they start writing letters, don't sign any contracts yet. And then they bicker down below. They argue about it. but they come to a common agreement, which is that we need to stick together.
And there is a multimillionaire in Chile, yes, who says, wait a minute, I will give each of these men $1 million, that they, which is Chilean pesos, not right. Hard dollars. And he does. But now their eye is on the sparrow, and they're thinking, that's all right, but it'll pay for a few things. But they want the bigger things. But right. One man does talk to what? A British news?
Yes, yeah. Yes. Yes, Mario Sepulveda, when he got out, gave an interview to a British reporter who was on the surface. Many actually other miners did not know he was even a reporter. They talked to him. He ends up writing a book. But Mario spoke to him a long time. And Mario gave this reporter enough information to write a book. And that made all the other miners really mad at Mario. Yeah.
Did you talk to Mario or did you not?
Oh, yes, I did. Mario Sepulveda is the person I spoke with the most because I spoke with him maybe 7 or 8 hours. I spoke with Mario over three different interviews, maybe actually 4 different interviews, 4 different trips to Chile, because Mario ended up being the heart of the story. I mean, that's why Antonio Banderas is playing him in the movie, because Mario was the most inspirational figure when they were trapped. He was low on the mining hierarchy. He's just a guy who operates a front loader. But as soon as this happened, he steps forward and says, we need to stay together, we need to ration the food. You know, he's very inspiring at one moment. We're going to show the world what Chilean men can do. And then he can be really sullen and angry and have these incredible mood shifts. Yeah. So he was just an amazing person to get to know. He inspired many of the men, drove many of them crazy. Half of them love him, said, Mario's the person who saved us. He's the real hero. And the other half of them think, that guy's crazy, I never want to see him again. And so Mario becomes this polarizing figure and the dominant figure in the book, really.
Hector, who was the one who ran, who ended up running alone down, down, down into what I would call hell?
That's Edison Peña. Yes, Edison Peña plays also a very important role in the book, because he's famous later as the guy who runs the New York Marathon a few months after being rescued. He goes to New York and runs in the marathon. He shouldn't have run it. People told him not to run it. He had never run a marathon before. In fact, before this happened, he was more of a cyclist than he was a runner. He also was someone who, before the accident, was emotionally troubled. So he suffered the most. Among the men, he was one of the ones who suffered the most, the psychological torment of being trapped. Edison has these beautiful, haunting soliloquies in the book, in which he talks about the madness of being in the dark, of thinking that you're going to die in the dark, die of hunger in the dark. He says the darkness is where hell is. And so he goes from being this man who's breaking down, saying we're going to die, to then, after they've been discovered, he starts to jog underground and starts to run. But yes, he is someone who's really suffered a lot too in the years since.
Yeah, that was a fascinating part. What's interesting is also you have now, at the end, brought us up to where are they today?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it seemed to me that that was really a key part of the story, because I started working on the book in 2011, 6 or 7 months after they'd been rescued. I was there for the first anniversary of the rescue, and then I kept going back, and I kept on seeing how the men were. And especially in the first interviews, it was clear that even 5 or 6 months after the accident, they were suffering from this horrible traumatic stress. Many of them were. I remember interviewing Alex Vega, one of the smaller miners, the man who tried to crawl under the rock, as you said. And he was trembling when I interviewed him. He could barely speak. And then I got to see him heal himself. And I realized that healing was also part of the story, was how do you pull yourself back together after this experience of 69 days in the dark, being tortured by this rumbling mountain. You've been told after you get out that you're famous, you're a hero, but you don't feel like a hero. You feel shattered inside. A lot of the men felt shattered, and yet the world was calling them a hero, and that was this colossal paradox for them. And so it was clear to me that that was part of the story, because what heals them ends up being family. It ends up being the routine of the home, going back to work. That's what heals them.
Even some who ended up going back into mine work.
Yes, yes. Several of the men end up back in underground mining, which for me was a haunting idea, the idea that you would be trapped in a mine and then come out, be called a hero, but then be forced out of economic necessity to go back and work in a mine. That was a terrible thing.
And yet the owners never paid a price.
They have not yet. They may pay in civil court, but they have not faced any criminal charges yet. No.
Hector, as you can see, I couldn't put the book down.
Oh, well, thank
you, wish
Connie.
Everybody to have the pleasure of reading this book. Will you autograph it
yes.
for me?
Thank you so
and
much.
And if you'd like to know what else I've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier, but support your local library. It needs all the help it can get. And actually, libraries today are like museums. So support it, and we'll see you next time. Thank you. Thank you.